live stream from all over the universe. People are watching us. So for all of you people in the outside world who don't know the procedures of the bound bag lunch talks, we don't have a formal introduction because we are limited in time, and we have to get out of this room by 1:30. And so I will briefly welcome our fellow Nathan Dennis from the University of Colorado. Matthew, sorry. Nathan Dennis, somebody else. Yeah. Matthew Dennis from the University of Colorado. All right, I'll get there.
To the west.
All right, somewhere there. And we've talked today about the bloody shirt, a material history of an American talk. So please, before I make another mistake.
It's really nice to be here and present this work. I haven't really had much chance to do it so far, so this is a great forum, especially given the audience who will know lots more about aspects of this than I do, and I have to learn a bit. And I also wanted to publicly thank Massachusetts Historical Society for funding some of this research and draw a lot from their collections of their texts and even their cabinet. So thank you. Let me go to the first slide because I wanted to talk a bit about the background that I'm using in the presentation. And what we see the red stripe going through is a piece of the flag that Colonel Elmer Ellsworth took down in May of 1861. It was unfurled across the river from Washington, where he was, and he went across the river with his men, and as it was raised at a hotel in Alexandria, Virginia, took it down, and in the process lost his life, becoming the first prominent casualty in the Civil War. He bled on the flag. The flag became immediately divided up in relics, and one section of it ended up in the Massachusetts Historical Society. I don't believe the section I saw had any actual blood on it, but who knows? It's a crimson, and it makes you know quite a spectacular background. Robert Frost's poem, The Flood, like Shakespeare's Macbeth, invokes the old English adage, blood will out. But the power of blood itself releases blood, Frost writes. It will have an outlet, brave and not so brave. Oh, blood will out, it cannot be contained. Blood safely confined and circulating in our bodies gives us life. Its escape under traumatic circumstances creates bodily crisis, sometimes with enormous social and political consequences when the bloodletting is prominent, massive, or public. Quality and quantity both matter. Lincoln's assassination on April 14, 1865, and the deaths of over 750,000 during the Civil War's 4 years, for example, both overwhelmed the United States. Even when such blood was stanched, it nonetheless continued to reappear, speak to us, and provoke us in the aftermath of that war and throughout American history, like Banquo's ghost or the imagined blood that incarnadined Macbeth's hands, no matter how much Lady Macbeth intoned, out damn spot. Today's presentation on the bloody shirt is drawn from a chapter in my book in progress, American Relics and the Politics of Public Memory. It seems improbable that a cult of relics, anything like that of medieval Christendom, would emerge in the United States. America, many have argued, was born modern and is the antithesis of medieval Europe. Yet Americans, though religiously diverse and reputed to be increasingly secular and forward-looking, found the political potency of relics too great to forgo. In this way, Americans were not exceptional. My project assesses their relics, publicly significant mortal remains, associational items and artifacts, and their shifting meaning and power from the colonial period to the present. The book's interpretive narrative focuses attention on exemplary relics, placing them in a broader context, using their histories to analyze the means through which Americans have used such things to shape their identities and to express and authorize their public words by making these words literally concrete. An ordinary pen became can become a sacred object, for example, when it's used, say, by a president to sign the Emancipation Proclamation and then carefully preserved as it is now in the Mass Historical Society. It might remain virtually indistinguishable from other contemporary writing implements. And yet such things can evoke extraordinary feelings, convey political messages, inspire action, and become priceless, while paradoxically at times becoming objects of commerce. Five thematic chapters that move in rough chronological order examine major questions in American history: colonialism, persistent in post-colonial America, the construction of national identity, or rather national and particular identities inflected by race, gender, region, slavery and anti-slavery, and the ironies, consequences, and perils of U.S. economic and military power in the late 20th century. And it will do so through material objects, the contents of burial mounds, mastodon skeletons, Revolutionary War mementos and mortal remains, the artifacts, grave sites, and trophies of westward expansion, the material vestiges of the Civil War, the bloody shirts that accompanied heated rhetoric, horrific lynching souvenirs and photographs, the heartrending detritus of industrial wars and the Holocaust, and most recently the relics of our so-called War on Terror. But today I want to focus on the peculiar power of blood-soaked souvenir garments in the American public sphere. Bloody shirts or coat shrouds or handkerchiefs seem to speak beyond the grave of those whose blood they salvaged. Sometimes they talk to us even as phantoms. More on that in a moment. Historically, instead of cleansing stains or discarding blood-soiled clothes, some Americans sought to preserve and deploy them to provoke or manipulate memory, particular purposeful remembrance, and to inspire action. Blood relics could arrest attention, shape identity, link Americans directly with dead heroes and martyrs, and inspire passion for the causes with which they might be linked. Thus, the power of blood could indeed release blood, nonviolent political passions, or sometimes new bloodletting in causes brave and not so brave, noble or reprehensible or ambiguous. The adage, blood will out, suggests that the blood of victims will somehow find and expose their murderers. Sanguinary objects, in fact, have been made to speak, not merely to honor the dead, but to identify villains and to enlist devotees in resistance, reform, or retribution. Such floods of blood and memory mark the unnatural disasters that have cycled through American history. Here we may witness the materiality, the coloring or crimsoning of public speech with relics commanding attention, shaping perception, and inflaming public memory. In the 19th century United States, bloody relics spoke chiefly about slavery, the violence that perpetuated and then ended it, and the injunction in the aftermath of the Civil War to achieve broad equality. Their employment, to paraphrase Lincoln's second inaugural address, and here we have an image of that, suggests, quote, that every drop of blood drawn by the lash shall be paid by another drawn by the sword. Though they were often deployed not merely with firmness in the right, as God gives us to see that right, but often without charity and with malice toward some. This image, I'm not going to really say much about, but one of the relics that I talk about in other sections of the chapter is that table. Right in the center of the picture, I don't know if you can see it very well, but there's a table and there's, I think, a glass of water on it, and that becomes an important relic that ends up transformed by its owner and ultimately, because it becomes too difficult for an individual to own, ends up in the Mass Historical Society later in the 19th century.
That white table, you're
saying? That yes, right in the middle, right, yes. Yeah. Yeah. The bloody shirt was a fixture in political oratory. So I wanted to talk about, well, what is the bloody shirt? And I assume everyone knows what that is, but that's an assumption these days that might not be wise. So let me just say a little bit about the bloody shirt itself. What is it? The bloody shirt was a fixture in political oratory in the 19th century United States, and it continues to resonate in American political discourse. It was most commonly associated with the radical Republican war horse, Representative Benjamin F. Butler of Massachusetts, and his Republican colleagues in the House and Senate, who in partisan fashion deployed the rhetoric and perhaps the material relic of bloody loss and recrimination against Democrats and the South in postbellum America, roughly through maybe the 1880s. "Vote the way you shot," they urged. "Those," quote, "those who shot the bullet for the Union and our country," they promised, should and will deposit the ballot for the same noble ends. "Remember those who had remained loyal and defended the Union, and remember and hold accountable those who had perpetrated disunion and committed treason." Here's some sheet music that makes that point. Oops. Or a political cartoon that also makes the same kind of point. Here on the top you have Grant, this is for the presidential election of 1872, and Horace Greeley, the Democratic nominee for the presidency, and he's surrounded by John C. Calhoun and Jefferson Davis, the president of the Confederacy, and above we see Grant flanked, of course, by Washington and Lincoln, with all the gloried accoutrements, the ivy and laurels and oak leaves, and below thistles and secession and treason and so forth. Or we can see it in a series of political cartoons, and I just want to go through these very quickly. These all come pretty much from the 1880s, and it's at a time when the bloody shirt has declined significantly in its political usefulness, at least for the Republicans. And here is a political cartoon that shows the editor of the New York Tribune in 1880, Whitelaw Reid, and what it's called the bankrupt outrage mill, and it basically suggests that he's just kind of pumping up these outrageous claims to inflame the electorate, to get them to act in ways that are irrational, controlled by their passions, not by their intellect. And in the upper right, you can see he has these bloody shirts and he has puppets that are kind of that supposedly he's deploying as if he's a puppet master trying to manipulate the electorate. And the suggestion is that all of these things, especially the reinstitution of white supremacy, just this devastating oppression of black populations, their disenfranchisement of so and forth, their lynching, is not true. It's just the kind of sort of thing that a newspaper editor is trying to promote. And there's a number of these, and I won't really go into them, but here you can see the bloody shirt being thrown out of office, get out of a job once more, along with the Republican Party in 1884, when for the first time since the Civil War, a Democrat, Grover Cleveland, won the presidential election. We have another one. Here's John Sherman and Joseph P. Foraker. Foraker was a candidate for the governorship of Ohio. Sherman was a prominent a senator from Ohio. They're blowing up the bloody shirt as a balloon with these supposedly overblown speeches, trying to make good use out of this relic. There's a sandwich board. The guy in front is the Democratic candidate. This is all about the race for the governorship of New York in 1885, and so the Democratic candidate is putting out his lieutenant governor candidate with a sandwich board, saying, he's also a general, and we also have a different version to tell. Whereas the guy behind actually has a kind of in a glass case on his sandwich board the bloody shirt. Here the purveyors of the bloody shirt, including James G. Blaine, the presidential candidate, with a bloody shirt on, as Rip Van Winkle-like figures to suggest they're way behind the time. They're just completely out of touch. Here is another one where the whole tactic has run aground, and the Flying Dutchman is this ghost ship. Its sails are bloody shirts. It's a ship that just continues to voyage ceaselessly without ever reaching port. And then finally, here's one from 1887 of John Sherman, to arms, the war ain't half over yet. But of course, by this point, the rites of reconciliation has tried to bring together North and South, really at the expense of achieving real equality and the abandonment of the important project of Reconstruction. But here, this is John Sherman. Let me cut through a thicket of introductory text that's in the larger chapter and get right to the point about the bloody shirt by posing an impertinent question. Did the bloody shirt, the thing, not just the political metaphor, actually exist? Did it have a real concrete referent or progenitor? Was the bloody shirt material? Was it more than a figurative red flag? And some commentators continue to make this claim. But in fact, there's virtually no evidence to say that Benjamin Butler or other Republican stalwarts or anyone else actually waved a real bloody shirt, at least in the political context of radical Reconstruction. So this is a fairly, this is a pretty strange admission in a talk about American material culture, I admit. The thing I'm talking about, in a sense, doesn't exist, but in other ways it does. Perhaps oddly, as 19th century speakers and audiences assumed they existed, that is, the bloody shirts really were material, or were likely to appear in public, bloody shirts assumed a near physical form. They circulated as a sort of political currency, backed not by gold, but by blood. And their virtual presence embodied by their absence, is a critical part of my story. One way to get at this paradox might be to briefly assess the definition of relic itself, or its related form, the relict, with a T. And so here's, to define a relic is actually a pretty complicated thing. And so I don't want to, really belabor it, but I do want to talk a little bit about what relics are and what they do, at least in the context of American political discourse. Common definitions identify the relic as a corpse, or more grandly, as an object venerated by the faithful because of its association with a saint or other sacred person. More generically, relics are ruins, residue, vestiges, souvenirs, and mementos, or monuments of the past. It's just the meaning from the root, to leave behind or to relinquish. We might notice, though, an alternate spelling lurking in our dictionaries, relict with a T. That once commonly referred to a widow. Relict can be read as the past participle form of relic, as in relict. Something or someone rendered residual, left behind after other parts have disappeared during a process of change. A relic or relict, Webster tells us, can be an object serving as a remnant, a trace of an otherwise extinct class or kind. So relic is a double-edged sword. The term and the thing connote both that which is relinquished and that which is kept, preserved, and venerated. The dead abandon while the living retain. In a paradoxical bargain that, like mortuary and memorial practices, both separate us from the dead and keep us close, aiding a kind of closure as well as remembrance. It has proved difficult to find actual bloodstains, if it has proved difficult to find actual bloodstained garments amid the figurative bloody shirts intoned in postbellum American oratory, it's absolutely clear that relics of war were painfully ubiquitous in these years. Speech makers could always count on their audiences filled with Civil War survivors to supply or in fact embody other incarnate relics of the rebellion, with their empty sleeves blowing against broken ribs and crippled bodies. The Cincinnati Daily Gazette, for example, described a speaker at an 1868 political event as a young soldier whose empty sleeve told of devotion to country and whose stirring words for the Christ and salvation moved hearts in the crowd that listened to his graphic recital of what God had done for his soul in a perishing world. In a sense, such orators and their audiences were living, breathing relics, those left behind who marked by their presence and absence, who incited memory. The trope of the empty sleeve was prominent in public discourse, as in this popular print by Winslow Homer, which first appeared in Harper's Weekly in 1865, Our Watering Places, The Empty Sleeve at Newport, which showed a young one-armed veteran forced to yield the reins of his carriage to his wife. And this, you know, this picture just calls out for a you know, deep, much deeper gendered reading than I'll apply apply today, but it's really graphic. Or Americans could encounter the trope in popular poems, like the lines excerpted here from "Driving Home Cows," which was often reprinted from its first appearance in Harper's Weekly in 1865. "Loosely swung the idle air, the empty sleeve of army blue, and worn and pale from the crisping hair, looked out a face that the father knew. For southern prisons will sometimes yawn and yield their dead unto life again, and the day that comes with a cloudy dawn in the golden glory at last may wane." And we can see it in some of these other images, some sheet music, for example, "The Empty Sleeve, a Song with Chorus" from 1866. Or here in this print, where we see the child, you know, cherub-like child on his or her father's knee looking into the empty sleeve. Or in another instance in this sheet music, "The Empty Sleeve," and here, one of McAleer's sleeves is empty here. Nonetheless, I have found. What I really want to emphasize here is the presence of a material absence with regard to human relics of the Civil War, with regard to the bloody shirt as a political object, and more generally as a critical mode of the relict with a T in American political discourse. I have found real, actual, material bloody shirts waved in the U.S. public sphere, and I want to offer one illustration of this drawn from my larger chapter. And so we turn to antebellum America as the Civil War approaches, and the infamous episode of the caning of Charles Sumner. The halls of Congress, the epigraph here is why I'm drawing from Shakespeare's Julius Caesar will be, I think, increasingly obvious. And I should also mention, that the title of the talk, "Dangerous Relic," comes from a part of the talk that I. Part of the chapter that I actually had to cut for time. So, but it refers to an 1852 oration by the Reverend Theodore Parker at a major meeting to commemorate the one-year anniversary of the rendition of Thomas Sims, who was captured by federal authorities in violation of the Fugitive Slave Act as an escaped slave and sent ultimately back to slavery in Georgia. On the one-year anniversary of that event, Theodore Parker arranged this huge get-together at the Melodeon Theater in Boston, and really in biting rhetoric called. Reminded Bostonians that Boston was the cradle of liberty, that it contained the bones of Hancock and Adams, and that these were dangerous relics, and that spoke in impertinent ways to the status quo, and that if Boston didn't rise to the occasion, they should be disinterred and sent back, you know, because the Boston itself wasn't worthy of them. And so I want to play on this expression a bit more in the talk. The halls of Congress had often been inflamed by impassioned speech, and they were not unfamiliar with violence, including other canings beyond the one that Charles Sumner famously endured. During a heated session in the House of Representatives in May of 1854, a friend of Preston Brooks, the caner, Henry A. Edmondson, a Democrat from Virginia, had even pulled pistols on Lewis D. Campbell, a know-nothing party congressman from Ohio. On that occasion, bloodshed was averted. Not so on May 22nd, 1856, on the floor of the Senate. Newspapers throughout the country reported the astonishing event and followed up with sensational stories about the subsequent developments. This world of print with partisan passion, swirling with partisan passion, untethered from later journalistic ethics that prescribed objectivity or detachment. If the press had helped create a public sphere in the early republic, or even earlier, by now it had helped produce an exceedingly more vast, pervasive, and cacophonous virtual public arena rife with divisions. Let me backtrack, because I think I should describe the events just a little bit. I got ahead of myself. So what does this refer to? Well, in May of 1856, Senator Charles Sumner became briefly the most famous and most polarizing man in America. Sumner was an outspoken and powerful voice in the Senate, and his Crimes Against Kansas speech, delivered over 2 days on May 19th and 20th, electrified both the North and the South, though it charged opposite poles in this case. But his sudden and shocking celebrity stemmed not from the status as an abolitionist champion, but from the fate he suffered as a battered victim of pro-slavery fury. On May 22nd, Sumner was attacked as he sat at his desk in the Senate, correcting proofs of his speech for publication by one Preston Brooks, a South Carolina congressman wielding a gutta-percha cane. Brooks' surprise assault on the defenseless Sumner for remarks Brooks deemed offensive might well have proved fatal. He continued to beat the fallen senator until his cane shattered. Sumner lay senseless, and Sumner's head produced pools of blood that ultimately drenched his collar, his shirt, and his coat. Sumner survived but became a martyr, his stained clothing transformed into relics, and so here was a genuine bloody shirt, a dangerous relic, and the press and public were ready. People would see pictures like this, and they would hear accounts in the press, and I'll talk about some in a minute. And they knew that, of course, that they couldn't believe everything they read. They knew that bias could color any account. And one of the things that that material objects could do is provide an alternative source of truth. That come directly from the thing. Things able to speak for themselves and to bring events near and make them concrete. And so it was with the caning of Sumner, in which souvenirs or mementos of the deed could help define reality and anchor counts in truth. These truth-telling objects, too, might be doubted or even feared when displayed when displayed to live audiences or broadcast through print. Such things like Sumner's bloody shirt could become dangerous relics, dangerous because they spoke, and dangerous because it wasn't always certain what they might say or might be made to say. Now, no one disputed that the caning occurred, but what did it mean, and how would that meaning be construed or constructed? So here is another epigraph from Julius Caesar, which in many ways is one of the most important cultural reference to the process of making blood-stained garments speak. But I want to go to this, a short article in the Richmond Whig from May 30th, 1856. The headline reads, Sumner's bloody shirt sent to Boston. This maltreated garment, we learn, has been conveyed by careful hands to Boston in advance of the august ceremonies which doubtless will mark its advent. Its patriotic constituency will have had their minds and hearts, if they have either, well stored for mutiny and rage by the fervid eloquence of their beecher saint. Now, the source of this intelligence was unnamed in the story, an elaborate burlesque that caricatured Sumner, abolitionist ministers, and Boston. Since 1847, the prominent abolitionist, the Reverend Henry Ward Beecher, had been minister of the Plymouth Congregational Church in Brooklyn, New York. The Richmond Whig writer presumably was unacquainted with a better choice for his parody, the Reverend Theodore Parker, a Boston activist actually involved in resistance to the fugitive slave law and complicit in the extra-legal support of anti-slavery forces in Kansas. But it hardly mattered. Beecher stood in for them all. This meek and holy priest is, we suppose, to officiate upon the occasion of the shirt demonstration, which will be made. As it is a new theme and may draw too heavily upon his imagination, we suggest to him to read Mark Antony's speech over the body of the beloved Caesar. The spoof imagined the waving of the bloody shirt as a new American practice, and so it facetiously named a text for prospective presiding ministers, that is, Shakespeare's Julius Caesar. The newspaper's article concealed a certain fear about what Sumner's gory garment might be able to say, and its lampoon seems designed to diffuse this potentially explosive testimony. At stake, as the piece stated, were the minds and hearts of Americans. Mark Antony's classic funeral speech of Act 3, Scene 2 begins, "Friends, Romans, countrymen, lend me your ears. I come to bury Caesar, not to praise him." Of course, Antony had a more ambitious agenda to sway the crowd against, quote, the noble Brutus, Caesar's murderer. And the Richmond Whig's verbal cartoon of a similarly ambitious orator on behalf of the nearly martyred Sumner exhibited suspicion regarding the motives and fears about the potential results of Northern eloquence, particularly when fortified by the sort of rent and bloodied raiment that Shakespeare had Antony deploy in 44 BC. The Whig continued in its Shakespearean paraphrase. "If you have tears, prepared to shed them now. We all do know this garment. I remember the first time Sumner put it on. 'Twas on the summer morning in his room, the day he hoped to overcome the triumvirate. Oh, now you weep, and I perceive you feel the dint of pity. These are precious drops. Kind souls, what weep you when you but behold our Sumner's vesture stained? Look you to yonder southern city where is himself marred by the hands of traitors." And then the paper imagines the response of northern citizens, like those moved long ago by Antony, and you see them here. "Piteous spectacle, noble Sumner, woeful day, oh traitor villain, oh most bloody sight. We will be revenge, revenge about, seek, burn, fire, kill, slay, let not a traitor live." And it continues, "Stop right there, right here, holy Beecher. The stones of Boston begin to rise in mutiny. It is the most excellent oration. It has done well its work. Grateful to the sufferer it will be for the mindful consideration of his classic tastes." So the Richmond Whig's parody was a preemptive strike against the sort of public speech and demonstration that had actually occurred at the Melodeon Theater in Boston in 1852, or worse. Might such events erupt in the wake of the caning? If so, the funeral speech burlesque aspired to delegitimize them and forestall their characterization as anything but dramatic fabrication and mutinies. Meanwhile, newspapers hostile to Sumner in Richmond and elsewhere published purportedly straightforward accounts with anodyne titles like "Investigation of Sumner Assault," designed to challenge Sumner's credibility, dispute the predatory quality or gravity of the assault, or question the severity of Sumner's injuries. Sumner's injuries were quite severe. Concussion, the blows had opened his scalp to his skull. He was, you know, debilitated for a long time, and yet we see Southern newspapers talk about his possuming, playing at being hurt, and questioning his manhood, and juxtaposing the supposedly heroic manhood of Preston Brooks with the wimpy behavior supposedly of Charles Sumner. The caning helped catalyze the New Republican Party, which met in Philadelphia that summer and selected John C. Fremont as its candidate for president. The Richmond Whig crowed that Sumner in his bloody shirt went into the Philadelphia convention only to be ignored and passed over. Sumner did not wear a bloody shirt in or coat in Philadelphia or anywhere else, as far as we know. Wishful thinking, tendentious politics, and a particular code of masculinity inspired the Richmond Whigs' comments. The editorial saw shame at the wrong end of a cane, a shame convenient for besmirching a troublesome and articulate abolitionist. And we have the cane, supposedly, possibly, in the Old State House Museum in Boston. Which I've seen personally. You can decide whether it's genuine or not. The Bostonian society has taken great pains to evaluate its authenticity, and I think from their point of view, the jury is out. I'm not sure that others feel the same way. And there are other objects that began to appear, celebrating the event. Meanwhile, if the waving of the bloody shirt in Boston occurred exclusively in the minds of pro-slavery Southerners and Democrats, in the South, Brooks supporters actually sought, venerated, and circulated their own relics. According to a letter that Preston Brooks himself wrote, he talked about his supporters, begging fragments of the cane he used on Sumner as sacred relics. And in one report from Spartanburg, South Carolina. As canes continue to pour in to Sumner in Washington to replace the one broken over the head of Sumner to Brooks, indeed one wrote on the deluge of canes. Indeed, though not after the former similitude, Colonel B, that is Preston Brooks, is likely to be a better caned man than his victim, and to be provided with an efficient weapon for each separate abolitionist now holding a seat in Congress. And so we see numerous objects commemorating the event and probably finding their ways into individual collections and becoming a different kind of relic. In some cases, various, his own constituents sent him accommodation and presented him with this goblets and silver pitchers and all kinds of objects began to accumulate. But meanwhile, Sumner remained himself as a living relic. If relic most commonly refers to an object esteemed or venerated because of its association with a saint or martyr, an inanimate physical trace, often the material remnants of someone or something that had once been alive, what of survivors? In the 19th century, as we've already noted, a relict with a T typically meant a widow or someone who endured. The widow remained behind as a living vestige of a marriage ended by the death of her husband. She was, in a sense, a living human memento. Sumner became such a relict, the survivor of his own martyrdom, able to keep and display the relics of his ordeal, wave his own bloody shirt if he chose to do so. Paradoxically, Sumner was both a venerated presence and a revered absence, the latter represented most powerfully by his vacant chair, the chair that he couldn't assume or continue to occupy in the Senate itself. And increasingly, the vacant chair became this other kind of purposeful and effective relic. And the longer that Sumner stayed out of it, in some ways, the more eloquent and fearful it became. Carl Schurz, the Civil War general and later Republican politician and statesman, on the vacant chair in 1874 on the occasion of Sumner's death, said, "Charles Sumner's empty chair became one of the most effective battle cries of the anti-slavery campaign. His constituents were content to let that seat wait for him and in the meantime stand empty, that eloquent empty seat preaching in its silence a most powerful anti-slavery sermon." The New York Evening Post had written in 1857, at present his vote would probably change no decisions in the Senate. His vacant chair is more eloquent than his presence would be, at least until the time shall arrive when he can uplift his voice with accustomed power. And Sumner himself observed in 1857 in a letter to his constituents, I was often encouraged to see that to every sincere lover of civilization, my vacant chair was a perpetual speech. And so here is a thing that speaks quite powerfully. But what about the bloody shirt or the coat, the dangerous relic feared and lampooned by pro-slavery opponents of Charles Sumner? What about the coat or the shirt itself, bloodied on the floor of the Senate in May of 1856? Though Southerners fully expected its political deployment, perhaps in the manner that Shakespeare's Mark Antony had wielded Caesar's rent and blood-stained gown, the evidence of his actual use by Sumner or others is mixed. Did Sumner's bloody coat circulate as a relic to stir and sanction these crowds? Apparently not. Yet there is evidence to suggest that relic-like, the coat inspired reverence, passion, and extraordinary action, at least in one man. In 1878, the Unitarian minister, writer, and editor, Charles Freeman Clark, published a memorial and biographical sketch of his friend Charles Sumner, writing, quote, that Sumner did as much for the cause of freedom by his suffering as he had done by his speech. When the news of that assault reached Boston, the city raised its voice against that cowardly, brutal, and murderous assault on a Massachusetts senator. Many a man, Clark wrote, took a vow of hostility in his heart against the institution which prompted that assassination. John Brown had likely made such a vow much earlier. Clark recalled the day he met the famous abolitionist and revolutionary. Quote, once while Mr. Sumner was here in Boston, still suffering from those injuries, I was passing his house in Hancock Street and went in to see him. He was in his chamber, resting in an easy chair, and with him were three gentlemen. He introduced one of them to me as Captain John Brown of Osawatomie. It was the first time I had ever seen John Brown. The men were speaking of the assault of Preston Brooks, and in the course of their conversation, Clark recalled, Sumner said to Brown, quote, the coat I had on at the time is hanging in that closet. Its collar is still with blood. You can go see it if you please, Captain. According to Clark, quote, John Brown rose, went to the closet, slowly opened the door, carefully took down the coat, and looked at it for a few minutes with the reverence of which with which a Roman Catholic regards the relics of a saint. Clark concluded, it may be that the sight of that garment caused him to feel a still deeper abhorrence of slavery and to take a stronger resolution of attacking it in its strongholds. So the blood of martyrs is the seed of the church. James Freeman Clark's testimony is striking and credible. And surprisingly, despite his Unitarianism, he seems to acknowledge and implicitly accept the mystical and practical power of relics, whether those of medieval Christendom or one like the bloody coat of modern creation. Yet others close to Sumner argued that he refused to manipulate the artifacts of his caning, and that he bore no particular animus towards his political opponent, even Preston Brooks. Sumner's secretary, A.P. Johnson, used the occasion of his 1874 remembrance to undercut the claims about Sumner's use of his blood-stained garment for personal or political advantage. Quote, and here it may be well, as far as possible, to dispose of some of the ridiculous stories still current, the secretary wrote. It has been said that the coat stiff with blood, worn by the senator when assaulted, was preserved. One touching statement details the awestruck appearance of old John Brown of Harper's Ferry when the coat was placed in his hands. An item went through the rounds of certain papers stating that the bloody shirt was once an exhibit at Exeter Hall and that it is still preserved by the English abolitionists as a holy relic. It has been also attested that the desk and chair the senator occupied when assaulted were kept in his study. None of this was true, Johnson declared. Quote, no person could be more averse to the preservation of such souvenirs than Mr. Sumner. The facts are that the coat went within the week to the cleaner and the shirt to the washerwoman and both into immediate use. The desk is still in the Senate chamber and is now occupied by Senator Ferry of Connecticut. The chair is used by another senator. They have never been taken from the Capitol. Johnson's characterization of Sumner's steady and unusual focus, not on the perpetrators of the assault, but rather on the evil, that is slavery, that inspired it, is compelling, as is perhaps his dismissal of Sumner's bloody coat as a political prop or relic. Johnson idolized and idealized his selfless hero, and he sought to elevate Sumner in the pantheon of public memory after his death in 1874. James Freeman Clark's memorial contradicts at least one of Johnson's claims, but the lack of other firsthand accounts chronicling the public, if not private, display of Sumner artifacts suggests that Sumner did not wave his bloody coat. Perhaps he didn't have to. That such activity was so broadly anticipated and feared suggests these relics' potency and their virtual, if imagined, presence. Sumner returned to the Senate in 1860. His chair was no longer vacant, and his bloodied shirt and coat had been cleaned, hidden away, or discarded. But the bloody shirt, as trope, lived on. How could it not, when so many shirts would be so eviscerated and ensanguined between 1861 and 1865? Thank you. And I would love to have comments and questions.
Please.
Who's collecting Trump riot artifacts?
Someone is. Absolutely someone is.
And the graphics, the handmade graphics,
right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Mind-blowing.
But if they're not being collected, it's not necessarily the case that they won't exist later.
Peter?
Yeah, so thank you very much. I guess I would like to, in a thought experiment, push you a little bit on your understanding of sacred, which may not be the same as your understanding of relic, but let's imagine a shirt worn by your dead father, yours, mine.
Yeah.
Is that a relic, or is it just a piece of material culture? You see, my point is that it may be the case that all objects, in fact, are invested with precisely the package of sentiments that you are identifying with, I'll call it sacred for want of a better term, and maybe just a little precision could be very helpful for your audience.
Yeah. I take your point. What I'm mostly interested in this particular chapter in the larger book is the public use and deployment of these things. And it's not unrelated to the private, but I'm more interested in how it is that these objects that are invested with great meaning can be exhibited in public to authorize speech and to naturalize claims that otherwise might be seen as more controversial or problematic. So, I thought you were going to kind of push me with a more more precise and technical religious kind of definition, and I'm really talking about I'm more interested in defining kind of sacred in whatever way that the people at the time are defining. And so the things that are have this particular kind of deep spiritual meaning, and to the extent that they can be effective in public discourse is really what I'm trying to focus on.
But in fact, if I could just go on a little bit more, if it's the display value that is what is of interest to you, there may be a whole array of objects that at the time had a powerful display or propaganda value, which would be anachronistic.
Yes.
And perhaps religious derived ones, if you can use that term, are just one of a group. Unless you want to say, in fact, that the religious side is especially significant, in which case that would take an argument to persuade us.
Yeah, I guess I'm not sure exactly what you're...
Either you can make the same argument without using any religious terminology whatsoever,
right.
Because all material culture does exactly mm-hmm. what you say relics as a particularly religious kind, sacred kind will do. Or you want to say that the sacred brings something that ordinary material culture doesn't have, but you haven't told us that either. So it's one or the other. That's my question.
I guess I'm not sure that I guess the only way I can really answer that is that, sacred is what audiences say it is. I think that different sorts of items could be deployed. I mean, blood happens to be something that is particularly potent, and in almost a kind of trans-historical way. But other objects could also be quite useful in speech, in public speech. And so I'm not disputing that. To the extent that these things have a kind of religious valence, it's simply because that's the context of American political discourse, I think, at least in the 19th century, which I'm talking about in this particular presentation. All kinds of material objects affect the way people understand and process speech. It might be, presidential candidates care what color tie they wear, for example, or, there's a lot of that goes into, should I show up in a limousine or should I show up on the subway? So there's a materiality to their message that is, subtle and sometimes powerful. But I'm really trying to look at things that are consciously deployed in a way that that is meant to elevate them and inspire a kind of passionate response. But I don't know if that really answered your question so well.
Cynthia?
I think that one answer you might have to that question is just that they're called relics because they have to do with martyrs. What I'm particularly interested in, being a medievalist and working on relics, they're usually about dead people.
Right.
And so many of these are not dead people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I think that's really fascinating, and your link of the relic to speech, it just in your comments a moment ago, seems pivotal to me, so that it becomes the material object speaking in the absence of actual speech, always. And when someone tries to use both together, waving the bloody shirt, they're ridiculed. Almost as if the bloody shirt screeches in addition to a screeching voice. And when the bloody shirt is left to quietly sit in the closet and have John Brown go and see it, then it's a moving testimony. The empty sleeve is a moving testimony mm-hmm. without any speech involved.
Yeah.
It's about a visual nature to these that is put in the place of speech. And I think the very fact that people are almost always alive in these things. These bloody shirts are for survivors, not usually.
I mean, the
ones you described.
Right. The classic bloody shirt is the that's interesting.
You were saying political candidates that have bloody shirts.
So. Yeah. The supposed original of this bloody shirt was a shirt obtained from someone who I think did survive, and supposedly. This is a northerner characterized as a carpetbagger who had gone down into the south, representing, he was trying to create educational institutions. He had run afoul of the, white supremacist mobs. He was beaten, and I'm not sure if he was killed, but he might have actually been a survivor. And then supposedly this shirt made its way back north up to Washington, to Benjamin Butler, and he supposedly waved it on the floor of the House or the Senate, depending on the version of the story, which is it can't be verified. But my sense is that the classic bloody shirt waved in postbellum Republican political oratory was taken from the dead, and many of the items that were in collections and then ultimately would go be displayed publicly. Were the contained the blood of those who had died in the Civil War, and so the implication was you should not forget those who had died as martyrs for this cause, and that to betray, to not vote in the right way was to betray their memory. So it could go either way. And sometimes they were the kind of remains of those who had survived, and others not so much. Mm-hmm. And so it is a complicated relationship that I still need to think more about.
Kelima?
Yeah, I'm wondering if there may be a way to expand or broaden this to give it a little bit more context. And I was thinking that, you know, we all know that the Victorians, and here I use it to include the Victorian reflection in America, were really obsessed with ideas about sensation, ideas about theatricality, ideas about melodrama, absolutely. And indeed, the whole rise of popular culture, you know, emerging at that same time, including a revival of the interest in Shakespeare. I was very interested by your reference. And John Wilkes Booth was a failed Shakespearean actor, after all. And I'm just wondering, and through to the end of the century, by the 1890s, with the emergence of, say, a new art form, film, where, again, those Victorian sensibilities are still very much dominant. I'm wondering if you thought to look in a few other forms, such as theater, such as the novel,
yeah,
to see where else and how else these ideas are. You know, you've looked at poetry, you've looked at the press, the popular press, but it seems to me it's everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And this notion of sensation and melodrama, most especially, really sort of capture or lead some of what you're presenting here, that sensibility.
I mean, I think you're right, and I think it is everywhere. In fact, that's kind of a scary prospect for me, because I'm already feel so extended chronologically in the book, and you know, cutting across all these disciplines where these things are studied very, very carefully over a long period of time, and substantial literatures that exist. But yes, I think this stuff, you know, is everywhere. And one of the things that's, I think, tricky, because the idea is the thing I'm interested in is how these material objects are deployed rhetorically. And so if the rhetoric is the use of the available means of persuasion, then one, you know, has to calculate the audience. And think about, you know, how it is that you can most effectively make your point. And so it might be, in some cases, it might be through subtlety, in other cases, it might be through more sensational kinds of approaches. The risk is that you can miscalculate and you can overdo it. And so it's clear that the bloody shirt, on the one hand, its power is shown by the fear of Southerners and of Democrats, the way that they actually use the bloody shirt more than the Republicans. By trying to say that it is just mere sensationalism, and to try to undermine the claims that Republican politicians are making about the real actual bloodshed that's occurring in the South throughout all this time, you know. As things go into the 19th century, I think there is that, you know, if a poem might work better than some kind of theatrical performance or not. You know, I think it just depends on the particular kind of calculation made at certain kinds of times. And I mean, we can go back earlier and we can see these calculations, say, in P.T. Barnum. The extent to which then an attempted, sincere, and earnest use of these objects can be seen as something kind of base like P.T. Barnum, or sensational like some other, you know, theatrical performance, is the kind of calculation and danger that I think that they face.
Peter had another comment.
I thought actually Cynthia almost solved our problem a second ago, that maybe the difference between material culture writ large and the type of objects you're talking about, the relics, is the relics speak themselves.
Yes.
They don't require text, whereas material culture, like in a history museum, if there's no wall panel next to it, you know, whose shoe is that? It doesn't mm-hmm. really matter, whereas that's not true. But now, in your answer to Eleanor's question, I mean, if the game is sort of the rhetorical object in late 19th century United States, then it's going to be more than just a relic that is a rhetorical object. There'll be other objects
sure.
as well that speak themselves.
Yes.
Could you just name sort of 10 of them? What's the boundary of your work? That's my question. What are the limits of what you're talking about?
I mean, I guess I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I mean, what I'm mostly interested in is the limits is really actually the space, the public space.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so it's what's going on in that public space is how it's, and so I'm interested in the way that material objects come in and are purposely deployed to augment certain kinds of political speech. And so that's pretty much it. So it's what shows up on stage. So and because it is such a vast topic, I mean, really is you know, kind of humbling, not kind of humbling. It's humbling that I'm approaching this in a selective, interpretive way. I couldn't imagine even trying to do it in a kind of exhaustive or fully documentary sort of way. And so what I'm mostly interested in is this political sphere at particular moments in American history when Americans are working out particularly important problems, the problem of, you know, what of colonialism and post-colonialism, or race and slavery and anti-slavery, and or the meaning of westward expansion and claims to land that is clearly owned and occupied legitimately by others, you know. So how do you achieve that kind of displacement rhetorically and politically and actually, and help actually disarm those who would criticize you by using a kind of almost unfair rhetoric, because you have objects that are speaking for you and with you, that have a kind of seem to have a kind of power to speak on their own. You know, less in what seems to be, they're mediated, but they seem to be less mediated. And so they seem to be, as you know, other scholars have talked about, not, you know, kind of second-hand or first-hand, but zero-hand kind of perspective.
Ivan, you had a question?
Yeah. A couple of things. This is fascinating. I'm really interested in this. But I wonder if you can help me to understand the difference between a relic and souvenir on the one hand,
yeah,
and secondly between a material thing and a literary or visual or otherwise representational topos on the other,
mm-hmm.
and then secondly, what's the status in your mind of contrived relics, if you like? I'm thinking of something such as the crown of thorns that Verena Davis brought to her husband in prison.
Yeah, these are all really good questions, and I would like to, you know, if I could, I would open up this to the audience to just help me with this. You know, there are many ways. What is a relic? What is a souvenir? What is a memento? What is, you know, that's a very tough question, and there's a lot of people have written very interesting things about this. And so I don't know that I could give a really short and definitive answer, because really, I mean, I'm using relic because that's what I find in the sources in the 19th century and beyond, even into the present. And I think one of the interesting things about that that word is the resonance with the kind of real relics from medieval Christendom. Clearly, they're different, but I think there's enough that's similar to give that term a certain usefulness and power. But so I really don't draw, you know, firm lines between these things, relic, souvenir, memento, because I think that sometimes they're used synonymously, and sometimes distinctions are made. And I could probably I could probably find or invent distinctions that might be useful for me, you know, making my point. But I think one of the things that's interesting about them is that it's a slippery thing, and it becomes even more slippery when I try to expand beyond just the American scene and look, you know, globally and historically. So I'm humbled by that, and I any suggestions that anyone wants to give me would be greatly appreciated.
I think Aaron has a suggestion. Yeah.
And then Catherine.
Yeah.
I mean, the difference between the kind of material and virtual or contrived and not. I'm not very interested in kind of exposing the fakes, you know, because I think that that's something that can be done. I'm more interested in why people believe in certain things and want to believe certain things. And it's interesting to me that even the real thing often isn't very impressive, you know, if it's taken out of its, you know, context or apart from its meaning. And so the pen that Abraham Lincoln used to sign the Emancipation Proclamation is just like any other pen from that day and age. And somehow it has this power. If someone actually, if that's not really the one, if Livermore, one of his kids or something switched it out, and then later he donated the not real pen to the Mass Historical Society, it still has the same meaning as if it was the real thing. So I'm really interested, you know, for my purposes, in the extent to which people believe or want to believe. And sometimes, you know, even the way that the debunking goes on is also very interesting. Because even though relics speak, they're dangerous in that they change what they say over time as context changes. So that's my short answer, but it's not a full answer.
All right, Aaron, Catherine, David. Yes, Aaron.
This question has been percolating over a number of the comments going back to Peter's relic and Alan's about other media. So I wonder whether thinking with some semiotic tools might help to make some of the distinctions that we're trying to make. So in my mind, what distinguishes a relic from other kinds of material culture items, and which is part of what adds to the aura of sacredness, is that semiotically speaking, they're indexical, that they're objects that maintained at one point, or are thought to have maintained, physical contiguity with that which they come to symbolize. They're indexes. Your zero-handed sort of way of framing it is along the same kinds of lines. And I think that's what grants them a certain kind of symbolic power, which is often, you know, couched in religious language. When Ellen was talking about other kinds of media, the one that where I thought she was going with this was photography, which is the media that its standard interpretation privileges an indexical relationship between the image and the trace and its source. So this led me to think about there's a book that came out about 10 years ago called No Caption Needed. It's about the circulation of iconic photographs in the 20th century. It's written by Harriman and Lucatus. They're political scientists, communication scholars. Their point is very similar to the one you're making, which is that some of the most famous photographs in the 20th century, the Hiroshima girl raising a flag at Iwo Jima, Dorothy Lange's migrant mother, they have a host of case studies. Their point is that these images circulate in the public and they gain rhetorical power. Their argument is exactly about the creation of a visual public sphere as opposed to a literary public sphere, a visual public sphere through the circulation of images that become iconic, familiar. And it seems to me semiotically what's going on in their case and in yours is that what starts as an index becomes an icon, that what starts as having power because of its either actual or presumed physical contiguity with its source becomes an icon as it's circulated away from that source, and as the ability to validate whether that contiguity is or ever was in place becomes negligible. And things that are iconic have a different kind of relationship with their source, and they may thus fail to be relics in the religious, historical sense, but that language may apply a certain kind of value to them by alluding to physical contiguity, even in its absence.
That's really useful, because photography is a real challenge for my project, because photographs are images and they're objects, and I'm still trying to work out the implications of that. And so, you know, one of the things that I've been emphasizing is really the index over the icon, because one of the things that I think is interesting, and other scholars have commented on this, is the way that that audiences want to somehow encounter the direct presence of the past. So an image, especially with that can be reproduced over and over again, it represents but doesn't connect physically in the same way that that a relic-like object can. I really know nothing about this, but icons, for those who actually understand them, are both simultaneously, right? I mean, that they are they're a kind of living presence as well as
yeah.
So I'm still trying to work this out, but I think you're right, and your suggestions are very helpful.
I mean, to paraphrase, it would be that the relic is not a type of object; it's a discourse of value.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
That's applied to certain objects to grant them a rhetorical weight that they don't have naturally, categorically, typologically.
Yeah, I think no. Thank you. That's really important. I mean, the other part of this project is that it actually, as a historian, I'm actually interested as well, not just in the kind of the historiography or the the way that the relic works, although that's very interesting to me. I'm also interested in the kind of the matters of what happened in the American past and how those things were enabled to happen through certain kinds of discourses. That's kind of another part of this. And one of the things I'm trying to balance is this kind of more kind of methodological kind of investigation and the substantive historical interpretation of the U.S. past.
Catherine.
Yeah, that is a really interesting talk, Matt. Thank you very much. And some of my comments actually relate to, again, some of the other questions that have been raised. I mean, I think, the 19th century is a really fascinating moment. It's a move from personal religion to sort of secular, right, belief systems. So you do have a long-standing discourse where these words like shrine and relic, right, are applied to things that are in fact secular, and particularly national, right? It's about a kind of object-based cultural nationalism, and it depends on visual rhetoric, material rhetoric, and then actual textual rhetoric, right? Because there's a sense in which they're polysemous, but they also have very specific meanings that those multiple forms of rhetoric can embed them in this kind of public discourse, as well as private discourse. So I'm thinking of a work like Teresa Barnett's Sacred Relics.
Yeah.
It's really interesting because her background's an oral historian, right? So she's very interested in the way that these objects get framed. And there's sort of the public shrine to the dead, like Nathaniel Bowditch's right memory cabinet to his son that he keeps, that you probably know from Mass Historical. There's sort of the cult of Washington. Mount Vernon becomes a shrine. Those kinds of objects associated with him end up, in at World's Fairs, that kind of thing, very much trying to create a public, I don't want to call it a religion, right, but a public belief system that's based on a form of worship and remembrance. That's a great question about, name 10 other objects, and that's sort of a place where you could look, and certainly this question of death and martyrdom, another word that's used particularly in war political context, is a really sort of, that's a place where these cluster, and there's a great example at New York Historical of a little framed photograph with Lincoln in the middle surrounded by laurel leaves that were taken from the, from his coffin as it traveled. But the woman who made this felt like that still wasn't enough, and so she inscribed, right, the story. So she's using this material, visual, and textual rhetoric, right, to make sure that meaning sticks. So it's an interesting question, how does the meaning stick, right, to these objects? And then thinking about this book that Aaron mentioned, we teach in this class we do is photography as material culture. And this whole notion of like, can the photograph communicate without text is really something we talk about all throughout the course, because the caption is critical, and whether or not you have it matters, and so does the context in which it appears. Mm-hmm. But in terms of the bloody shirt, I was thinking about the discourse around Trayvon Martin, right? And that's that's a bloody hoodie, right? Yeah. We actually just have a student who did a qualifying paper on the sort of the iconic qualities of the discourse this object's embedded in. I mean, we could have dams right here, and it both isn't that hoodie, but it relates to that hoodie, especially if it's activated, over your head. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I think there are a lot of really interesting.
Yeah,
them. There you go. All of a sudden, does he become scary? Some people would say yes. So then, how does that? I think you're grappling with really interesting questions, and I think there are sources. But I think you're absolutely right on being very attentive to the specifics of the historical moments and the discourse that those objects are embedded in. I think that's critical. Thank you.
Thank you. That's very useful.
Paul?
Some of my points have really been raised in other questions, but what I was going to say is that it strikes me that the bloody shirt is, or something equivalent to it, whether a relic or related to martyrdom, is if not a constant, it's a recurring motif since the rise of the secular sphere. And in a sense, you can make sense of this depending on the conditions under which that period or that event is being described. Many of the points you were raising, I was reminded, were raised by I can't remember his name now, but the English royalist observer of the execution of Charles I, who it's often pointed out was perhaps the first use in English of a secular relic and a martyr. Mm-hmm. And yet you could go right up to Trayvon Martin's hoodie and say that these have been deployed by political agents at every stage. So what we've really got then is a topic about American politics in the 1850s, not the bloody shirt, which in a sense is a trope or a recurring pattern mm-hmm. since the emergence of the public and secular sphere in the 16th, 17th century.
I am interested in it beyond the 1850s, but in the American political context, public context, absolutely. And I think, I think it just shows that, with the citation of Julius Caesar, Shakespeare's Julius Caesar, it just really suggests that this is something that is, not just being made up in the United States, but it becomes something particular. At particular times in U.S. history, and so I'm interested in that particularity. I'm interested. I'm informed. By the comparisons, but they just really ultimately will overwhelm me if I try to pursue them too much. It's interesting. There are times in the chapter I include some, but where Americans are trying to kind of historicize the trope. And they offer all kinds of reference beyond Julius Caesar, but they to Scotland and to Sardinia and to Corsica and to all these other places, in a much more distant past, and it's all about kind of ways to powerfully invoke memory and to incite some kind of revenge.
So the bloody shirt in itself is just a kind of red herring.
If red herring is seems as a material object, so that maybe that would be my next work. But I think the thing is if it's a red herring, it's a very useful one that's used a lot, and its uses change in I think interesting ways.
David, just one comment. I mean, the thing is that the bloody shirt begins with the shirt of Nessus. This is in Greek mythology, and that's what I was always thinking of going through, is kind of a revival of classical motifs into American culture that we know from early American, 18th, 19th century culture, right? In which there is this revival of ancient Republican mythological motifs from Roman and Greek times, and that is just how they're using it. And that's why they're inventing their own bloody shirt in order to invent their own republic or invent their own 19th yeah. century in a way. But David had a very important question.
Well, I was curious about, though we've got enough time, about sort of periodization in that, in your use of the illustrated newspapers.
Yeah.
Because those are almost all mid-1880s.
Yeah.
And I was just thinking about, even based on this discussion, you know, this is, by then, almost all of those bloody shirts were marked bloody shirt.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Which made me think of, you know, talk about the sort of deracination of this process. Yeah. 1985, we have a very different readership audience, as well as a much more afraid use of it in political discourse. And at what point, you know, how are you going to operate in terms of when this is a sort of powerful discourse versus its faint traces to some extent? That are maybe waived, but evoke much less successful, you know, if you want to go back to the historical past. Here's evidence of something, but who knows if it really worked, or the visual evidence would seem to suggest it's much weaker.
Yeah. I mean, I think it is, you're right, that it's ironic that that my best examples of the trope is when it's being lampooned because it no longer has its power that it once had.
Mm-hmm.
But actually, that what that did for me was to provoke a certain investigation of that power, because you know, it clearly, if it was being dismissed, at some point, it's probably because at some point it actually did have some power, and so I was interested in looking in earlier times when it did, and then finding the references during the caning controversy. Where it's actually being, the bloody shirt is being used very much like, you know, more by the opposition than by the abolitionist or the sympathetic to Sumner himself. So you know, there's a certain waxing and waning, at least in that kind of bloody shirt. But it's clear that the use of blood and the use of objects that somehow are able to connect people with some kind of disastrous event or crisis, you know, still has a certain power.
You had a question. I don't know if you still have it.
It's another unwelcome suggestion, I think. But I was thinking about it since you're talking about the 19th century theater and stuff, because yeah. I think it would be interesting to look at the elementary school curriculum, because which you could probably do at the Antiquarian Society. My dad, you know, went to school in a very small town near the Canadian border in North Dakota, so not a very sophisticated environment, and it was 20th century, but they may have been behind the times. But he had a quote from Tennyson or, you know, other great 19th century poets for every occasion. Every time something came up, he had a, and someone told me that in fact that was a big part of the curriculum, was memorizing poetry. And not ancient poetry, but recent. I don't know that they did Shakespeare, but certainly the great 19th century poets, my dad knew by heart. And so, you know, I think as a frame of reference that people might put these things into, it might be interesting to know which poets they memorized, if it's possible to know that.
Any other last question? Almost last, yes?
I was wondering, have you thought about the like global influences at exactly that moment, like the Mexican independence and Maximilian's bloodied shirt that's, you know, immediately photographed, invited, and this photographer invited to the execution, and then it's turned into postcards and mass reproduced and circulated. That just seems so precisely at the same moment that Benito Juarez kind of instrumentalizing that trope. That's what might be interesting.
Yeah, I'll look into that. That's a great suggestion.
Does your project go into the 20th century?
Yes.
Yes? Where, and it's always about the bloody shirt? Or
well, this, no. This particular chapter will go into the late into the 20th century. And the whole book actually is chronologically too vast.
Because I was thinking about relics, political relics, that always use you know, bodily fluids. I mean, the Monica Lewinsky dress and its function, it's basically a similar story here. You know?
Did it exist or did it not exist?
Apparently
it was a left and right debate. It was used politically. It became a relic in a way. So I was wondering to what extent we continue with this story. I couldn't think of any bloody examples. I'm sorry.
No, it's it's everywhere.
Yeah.
Well, if you think about, I was thinking about the Jacqueline Kennedy, the pink suit that she wore that she was wearing with the assassination, I was thinking about it because this the dress was given to, I think, the Maryland Arc somewhere, and it's. It can be on view. They can put it on display, but in 100 years, so they can put it on display in 2103. And I was thinking about it in relation to JFK clothes, because those are not they cannot become kind of relics because they are evidence. Like they're not going to be on display ever. Mm-hmm. So it's the one that becomes. Like an iconic, an icon of that moment is the one of the people, the person who survived, not the one.
Mm-hmm.
And how does this relate to the fact that it becomes a relic?
I'll have to work that out. It's a great point, and the trick of the rhetoric is to. Use these things effectively without becoming creepy and having the actual opposite effect and a kind of repulsive effect on your audience. And the line I think probably shifts over time. But part of the chapter, I really didn't talk about Lincoln and all the relics.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, there's nothing bigger than that in the 19th century.
Mm-hmm.
And I think they work in a different way, and I didn't really have time to get into that. And I'm sure need to work some things out. But in a sense, they were too sensitive to be deployed in the same way that, say, some infantryman's shirt and bloodstained Bible. Could be used rhetorically. Lincoln was just, he was kind of too close to
a real saint,
mm-hmm. To really be used that way.
Jackie Kennedy patterned the cortege, the funeral procession on photographs of Lincoln's funeral.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I do have a section in the chapter about Martin Luther King Jr.'s assassination in 1968 and the blood associated with that. And there you can really see the kind of fine line between what is generally accepted as appropriate and completely inappropriate, from a lot of different perspectives.
Well, on that note, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.